acute myeloid leukemia and will be presented by Dr. Mansoor Al-Jabri. Dr. Al-Jabri is a consultant and assistant professor at King Saud University and King Khalid University Hospital.
First of all, I should thank the organizing committee for that kind invitation, and I hope it will meet their great expectation. And namely, I should thank the Dr. Shihab Al-Mashhadani, the father of hematopathology program, and our pioneer senior resident, Haytham Maher Abdullah Ibrahim, and others. And I hope my voice will be recognizable because I partially recovered from laryngitis. So I hope it will be recognizable. Now, actually, my topic is about acute myeloid leukemia. And as you know, acute myeloid leukemia is a huge topic, and it represents about 25% of our daily work. So actually, when they asked me to talk about that huge topic, I stopped for a moment and asked myself, should I take that huge topic from general aspects in order to cover all the important points, or should I choose highly specialized topic in order to give all the updates in that topic? Then I decide to go both ways, to take all the advantage, and unfortunately, I'm sure that I will take some disadvantage, but I will try to minimize it as much as I can. So don't be surprised if you see a highly generalized slide followed by highly specialized slide. Now, acute myeloid leukemia is aggressive clonal hematopoietic disorder derived from either hematopoietic stem cells or lineage-specific progenitor cells, which manifest as accumulation of abnormal myeloid blasts in bone marrow and peripheral blood, leading to bone marrow failure manifested as anemia, thrombocytopenia, and neutropenia, and also to organ infiltration, leading to hepatosplenomegaly and rarely to lymphadenopathy. And now, the next slide will be a highly generalized slide, so don't be surprised if I summarize the pathogenesis of AML in one slide. AML is a truly multifactorial disorder in which a single factor is insufficient to cause the AML pathogenesis, and we need a combination of multiple factors in order to have acute myeloid leukemia phenotype. And those are the most common predisposing factor. Genetic predisposition, any genetic disease that leads to genetic instability or DNA or impaired of DNA repair mechanism, such as Down syndrome, Noonan syndrome, Le-Fermani syndrome, will predispose the patient for acute myeloid leukemia. And environmental factors, mainly benzene exposure, cigarette smoking, ionizing radiation, infections such as viral or many bacterial infection, previous therapy, namely topoisomerase II inhibitor or alkylating agent, will predispose the patient for a very bad type of acute myeloid leukemia, which is the therapy-related myeloid leukemia. Other hematological disorder, MDS, aplastic anemia, or myeloproliferative neoplasm, all those factors will trigger the genetic shift by unknown mechanism, because we don't know exactly what happens pre the genetic alteration, which manifests like a chromosomal translocation, inversion, or overexpression of oncogene such as FLT3 or KIT or whatever. So we do not know exactly what happened at the genetic level, but we could monitor the result of that genetic alteration by cytogenetic, by molecular, by SNP array. And that unknown mechanism will lead to genetic alteration in the immature precursors, which will give us which will give us the phenotype of acute myeloid leukemia by one or two or three or four mechanisms. The first mechanism is block of differentiation when we have maturation arrest at one level of hematopoietic process, such as FLT3 or KIT mutation, which is tyrosine kinase, tyrosine kinases, and NRAS and KRAS. Enhanced proliferation is the second mechanism which will lead to rapid growth of those abnormal cells. And decrease of apoptosis, this is the third mechanism, decrease apoptosis and epigenetic modification, which is various molecular genetic that leads to chromatin, chromatin remodeling without affecting the DNA sequences. And the best example here is DNA methylation or histone acetylation. So now you could take that slide like a general frame for you when you want to read about the pathogenesis of acute myeloid leukemia. Now I will go to my main topic, which is case tip in AML diagnosis. This is the WHO classification, which is the widely accepted classification, and they divided the AML to five major categories based on a preclinical condition, blast count, genetic, and the immune phenotype of those blasts. The first category is therapy-related AML. Any previous chemotherapy like topoisomerase inhibitor or alkylating agent with increased number of blasts and previous chemotherapy, it is therapy-related AML. AML with recurrent genetic abnormality, we have seven recurrent cytogenetic abnormality and two extra provisional entity. Myeloid leukemia associated with Down syndrome. The Down syndrome actually, this is interesting biological entity because some of myeloid proliferation, they show mysterious property of spontaneous regression. So they have been brought under separate category, and we need to exclude the transient abnormal myelopoiesis if the blast exceeds more than 20%. Now, AML with multilineage dysplasia, this is a new category which has been added 2008 to include any AML with significant dysplastic changes, either 50% dysplasia involving more than two lineage or MDS-related genetic abnormality or previous MDS. And now, if you cannot assign the AML for any other entity, now we should use the previous FAB, but they gave him a new name, AML not otherwise specified. Now, this algorithm, actually, sometimes you will face one case which could fit for different entity, so you need to have a diagnostic algorithm to approach such cases. Now, what are the pre-requirements for acute myeloid leukemia? The blast count is the cornerstone in the diagnosis of AML. So you cannot diagnose AML unless you have blast count more than 20%. If the blast count is less than 20%, you should ask yourself and you should check if there is any blast equivalent present. And I will talk in detail about what do we mean by blast equivalent later. So you should calculate the blast percentage plus the blast equivalent. If it exceeds 20%, this is AML. Now, if the blast and blast equivalent are less than 20% and the patient has actually highly suspicious to have acute leukemia, you should proceed doing cytogenetic and molecular to check if there is any one of the recurrent cytogenetic abnormalities such as translocation 821, inversion 16, translocation 16-16, or translocation 15-17. So with those translocation, you do not need to fulfill even the threshold of 20%. And now, if the patient is fulfilling those translocation, yeah, you could diagnose him as acute myeloid leukemia. But now, if he's not fulfilling all the above mentioned criteria, you should check if there is erythroid hyperplasia, and the cut point is 50%. If the erythroid in the boomer or more than 50%, now you should calculate the blast out of non-erythroid blast. And now, if the patient is not fulfilling all those criteria, you should check if it is MDS or MBN. It's not acute myeloid leukemia. So now, this is the first step in diagnosis of acute myeloid leukemia. And when you are sure that you are dealing with acute myeloid leukemia, you have to assign it for the proper entity, because it has different prognosis and management. Now, if you are sure that you are dealing with acute myeloid leukemia, first of all, you need to exclude, you need to check if there is trisomy 21. As I said before, it is interesting type, because it has distinctive clinical and genetic imprint. So you need to exclude the Down syndrome. If the patient has Down syndrome, you should check whether it is transient abnormal myeloid or it is real myeloid leukemia. And I will talk later about how to differentiate between TAM and real leukemia if you can. And now, if the patient is not Down syndrome, you should check the previous history, if he has any previous chemotherapy. This is therapy-related AML. And then you need to check the recurrent cytogenetic abnormality. If there is, it is AML with recurrent cytogenetic abnormality. And then if there is no recurrent cytogenetic abnormality, you have to check the MDS-related changes, namely the dysplasia or previous MDS, or recurrent cytogenetic abnormality associated with MDS. And now, this is the new professional entity, nucleophosmin, or CAPPA, which is molecular diagnosis, actually. And now, if you cannot assign it for any one of those category, you should check the AML. It will be AML, not otherwise specified. Now, in order to understand the AML and otherwise specified, you have to understand the journey of the hematopoiesis, because it's closely follow the fourth step of the hematopoietic journey, from the hematopoietic stem cell to the mature cells. Hematopoietic stem cells is a multipotent, self-renewing cells. Actually, it is a result from the totipotent mesodermal hemangioblast. And the hematopoietic stem cells, as I said, it's pluripotent, so it can synthesize any cells in the blood in the blood system. Then it will divide to lymphoid stem cells and myeloid stem cells. The myeloid stem cells will divide to three progenitor, megakaryoblast, erythroblast, and granulocyte monocyte progenitor. And then it will further divide to myeloblast or monoblast. The myeloblast also could give the promyelocyte, and monoblast will give promonocyte. Up to this level, we are dealing with immature malignancy. But If we exceed this level, we will reach the mature neoplasm, namely myeloproliferative neoplasm. Now, actually, it depends at which level the mutation occurs. If the mutation occurs at the hematopoietic stem cell level, it will give us the acute myeloid leukemia of ambiguous lineage. Whether it is acute or differentiated leukemia, when we have only the stem cell marker without any lineage-specific marker. Or we could have two population of blast, each blast expressing lymphoid or myeloid marker, which is the biphenotypic or bilineage. If the mutation occur down at myeloid stem cells, it will be acute myeloid leukemia with minimal differentiation or minimal maturation, or without maturation. The acute myeloid leukemia without minimal differentiation, when you don't have any cytomorphological evidence of myeloid nature. So namely, you will not see any our road, you will not see the MBO and Sudan black by cytochemistry will be negative. So the only way to prove the nature of myeloid blast is by flow cytometry. And usually it is MBO negative, so you need to have at least two markers, either CD117 or along with one of CD13 and 33 if MBO is negative. Acute myeloid leukemia without maturation, when you have the blast count is the predominant cells, it's more than, by definition, more than 90%. If the mutation occur down at the granulocyte, monocyte, progenitor, it will give you M4 when you have two population of blast, monoblast and myeloblast. M2 is a little bit mature myeloid neoplasm, and M5 is exclusively for monoblastic lineage, and it could be M5A or M5B when the predominant cells is the promonocyte. M7 mainly megakaryoblast, and M6 is erythroblast. I'm sure that you are all familiar with this, but let me to give you the first case. Now, this patient is 4 weeks old infant presented with fever and jaundice. On examination, he has mild hepatosplenomegaly and no lymphadenopathy. He has moderate leukocytosis and hemoglobin is 12. Platelet, and he's mildly thrombocytopenic. And look at those, this is the peripheral smear, and it shows around 33% immature cells. Who can tell me what is the, what are the morphology of blast? What do you think? What are those things? Those are the cytoplasmic blebbing, which is going more with with megakaryoblast. Who can guess what is the morphological feature of the blast? Which type of blast we are dealing with? High incidence ratio, basophilic cytoplasm with cytoplasmic blebbing. Yeah, it is megakaryoblast. Now, this is the bone marrow. The bone marrow showed around 60% of those cells, many megakaryoblast, and there is erythroid hyperplasia also, and there is dysplasia in the megakaryocyte. This is binucleated megakaryoblast, and the myeloid and the dysplasia in the myeloid is minimal. And this is the flow cytometry. The flow cytometry showed around 53% blast, which are positive for CD45. And positive for CD41 and 61 and also CD34. So what do you think here? What is the diagnosis here? And what is the next? Before you say the diagnosis. Yeah, so you need what? The karyotype. The karyotype. This is the karyotype. Yes, and trisomy 21. So what else you need to do now? You should do, what is the pathognomonic genetic defining feature for Down syndrome related myeloid proliferation? GATA1 mutation. And this is the GATA1 mutation. It is mutated, and GATA1 is transcriptional factor located at chromosome X, and it is responsible about the normal maturation of megakaryocyte and erythroid precursors as well. And a complete deficiency of that transcriptional factor will lead to what? Will lead to congenital megakaryocytic thrombocytopenia, while the activating mutation like here will lead to hyperproliferation of megakaryoblast mainly. So now what is the diagnosis? Yeah, it is myeloid proliferation related to Down syndrome. Is it transient abnormal myeloblasts or a real leukemia, myeloid leukemia associated with Down syndrome? Can you predict or can you tell with sure? Yeah, actually by morphology and by immunophenotype, the blasts are indistinguishable. But sometimes even by the clinical situation, the transient abnormal malabsorption may present with life-threatening condition like myocardial fibrosis. So I try actually to summarize the main differentiating point between the transient abnormal malabsorption and real leukemia, because actually it make big difference in the management whether to stay and to close follow up this patient or to start the chemotherapy immediately. Now, usually transient abnormal malabsorption, it affects the neonate exclusively, and usually they will resolve by 3 to 8 months. While myeloid leukemia, it could affect mainly the young children from 5 to 4 years, but this does not mean it does not affect the infant. The infantile leukemia is a well-known entity. And now, the another differentiating point is the dysplasia. Myeloid leukemia associated with Down syndrome is usually associated with tiny dysplasia, and this is why actually according to the WHO there is no biological difference between acute myeloid leukemia and MDS. So usually they will be associated with dyserythropoiesis and dysgranulobiesis. So if you see dysgranulobiesis, it is less likely to be transient abnormal malabsorption. And now the main differentiating point here that you could differentiate 100% is the genetic study. If there is any MDS associated cytogenetic abnormality such as monosomy 7, 5q, this is acute myeloid leukemia, it is not transient abnormal malabsorption. If there is MLL rearrangement, this is infantile leukemia and it is not also if it is translocation 122. Now, what if we examine this patient and we discover that this patient has translocation 122, what category we should classify this patient? What? Recurrent cytogenetic abnormality. Any other? Yes, still Down syndrome. Yes, because the Down. This is. Yes, it is not. We should not classify him as recurrent. Yes, it is. He is Down syndrome. And look at GATA mutation. As I said, it is pathognomonic defining feature for the Down syndrome related myeloid proliferation. And any case without GATA1 mutation, we should diagnose him as conventional AML and not Down syndrome related myeloid neoplasm. And usually, interestingly, and actually we don't know exactly what happens, that the GATA1 mutation will disappear during the remission. But you have to be careful that about 25% of the patient, of TAM patients, will transform to real acute myeloid leukemia. So you need to close follow up then. And now, this is another topic actually. The blast is the cornerstone in diagnosis of acute myeloid leukemia. And despite it is so basic issue, sometimes it is not very simple. So I will talk about blast and mainly blast equivalent in that few slides. So this is the myeloblast, which is, I'm sure that you are all familiar with it. Large cells with high NCA ratio, prominent nucleoli, plus minus our roads, it will be MBO and Sudan black positive. By flow cytometry, it will be CD30, 33, MBO, and CD34. So who could predict what type of what type of the special entity that is associated with something here? I hope it is clear. 860. This is what? This is our road. 821. It is associated with long tapered our road. Yani this is just for fun. Now, The first blast equivalent is promyelocyte, and it should be counted as blast equivalent only in ABL cases. And usually it is large cells with irregular eccentric nucleus, slightly condensed chromatin, abundant cytoplasm with numerous granules, if you can see here, and plus minus multiple hour rods if we have phagocyte cells. And as I said, it's equivalent to the blast only in ABL. And usually it is the highest cell that show strong positive of MBO by flow and by cytochemistry also. And characteristically, they will be negative for CD34 and HLA-DR. And they will be bright positive for CD33. Now, what is this? Yes, this is the monoblast. And usually it is large cells with round to oval nucleus. And this is very important because sometimes you need to differentiate between the monoblast and this cells. What type of this cells? That side. What type of this cells? This is promonocyte, which is actually, it's blast equivalent, and it should be count, especially if you are dealing with M5B. And sometimes it is very difficult to differentiate between the CMML at accelerating phase and more acute monoblastic leukemia, acute monocytic leukemia. But how to differentiate between monoblast and promonocyte? The monoblast usually is around to oval nucleus, and the promonocyte is highly convoluted nucleus with numerous faccules in the sky bluish cytoplasm. And now, by cytochemistry, they are positive. They are all positive for non-specific S-rays. And actually, to understand the difficulty of recognizing the monocytic lineage, look at this article, which has been written after extensive workshop done by panel of experts, Barbara Bain, Ghulam Mufti, and others. They hold that workshop only to define the monoblast, promonocyte, and the monocyte. And they talk about a very interesting type, the immature monocyte, which is mature monocyte. I mean, it is monocyte and it should not be counted as blast, and the monocyte. When they actually go to how to differentiate between monoblast and the monocyte, the concordance rate was very high, 95%. But when they go to how to differentiate between promonocyte and the immature monocyte, the concordance rate lowered to 60% at the expert level. So sometimes it is very difficult. And how to differentiate between the monoblast and promonocyte by flow cytometry? The best way, actually, and they all will be positive. They could be positive for CD60, for CD14, 11C, 11B. But the best way, actually, for flow cytometry to use the CD64 at the axis, at the vertical axis, and to put the CD14 against, I mean CD14 in the horizontal axis. The first box will be negative for both, which represent the early monoblast. They will be negative for both. Late monoblast and immediate and intermediate monoblast will be positive for CD64, but it will be negative for CD14. The promonocyte will show will express CD64 plus minus CD14, and the monocyte actually it will show like horse show shape, and the monoblast will be usually negative to dim CD64, and it is negative for CD14. But the promonocyte are usually positive for CD64, and it is mainly the immature promonocyte will be negative for CD14, and late promonocyte will be positive for CD14. The mature monocyte usually will be bright CD14 positive, and it could express CD64, and it could not. So now the last slide in this topic is the erythroblast and megakaryoblast. And the erythroblast is large cells with slightly condensed chromatin, nucleoli variably prominent, and usually it has deeply basophilic cytoplasm, and it is PAS stain positive. And by flow cytometry, it will be glycophorin A positive, hemoglobin A positive, and CD71, while it is negative for CD34 and NBO. And interestingly, it will be ecadrine positive. Ecadrine is a new marker. It is selective for immature erythroblast, and actually many studies show that it is the most sensitive and specific marker for immature erythroblast, namely pro-erythroblast and basophilic erythroblast. So you could use it against glycophorin A to determine the maturity versus immaturity of the erythroblast. Megakaryoblast is medium to large cells with round or slightly irregular nucleus with agranular basophilic cytoplasm with distinct blebs. And but you have to be careful that lymphoblast variant could be seen, and it tends to be megakaryoblast. And usually they will be positive, more importantly for CD41, CD61, and they will be bright CD33, and they will be negative for erythroblast markers. And now look at this case. Now we have been provided with this flow cytometry from acute leukemia case, and assume that all other markers not shown here is negative. And so this patient, it shows homogeneous population of blasts which are shows intermediate side scatter. It's not high side scatter. It is not low at the at the blast gate, and they are dim CD45. When you expose them to CD34, it shows continuum expression, and mainly it is positive. Around 30% of the blasts are CD34 positive. CD117 is bright, homogeneous positive. HLA-DR clearly negative. CD13 is partially positive. It is positive. And CD33 is bright, very bright positive. CD2 again is positive. So what kind of blast fit more with the previous flow cytometry? What is this? What is this? One, number one. Myeloblast, look at this. What is this? What is this? A promonocyte. What is this? This is the microgranular promyelocyte. What is this? Monoblast. And finally, what is this? Lymphoblast mainly. So what kind of blast fit more with the previous flow cytometry? Number four. Yes, it is the microgranular variant of ABL. Now, look at this very interesting article which has been published 2012 from USA. They take 100 case of proofed ABL translocation 1517, and they study the pattern of immunophenotyping by flow cytometry. And interestingly, they found that there are four distinct patterns by flow cytometry. The more around 73% of the cases is the classical ABL, the hypergranular ABL, and 20% is the hypogranular variant. And actually, when we compare between the hyper and hypogranular variant by using the side scatter, the hypergranular usually will show increased side scatter at granulocytic region, and hypogranular will show low at plastic region. CD2 is very important differentiating point between them, because CD2 in hypergranular will be negative, but at hypogranular will be 80% of the cases will show positivity for CD2. CD4 It could be positive in about 24% of both cases, and CD11B, CD11C, CD14, HLA-DR, those are very important marker, especially if we are dealing with hypogranular variant. Why? Yeah, because the number one differential diagnosis by morphology is monoblastic leukemia. Now, look at CD34 is almost negative, 4% of the hypergranular variant, but it shows around 75% in the hypogranular. And interestingly, it shows continuum expression, but about 30% is positive for CD34. And now this is the pattern 3, which shows mixture of blast and promyelocyte. It's only 4 cases. You could see this is the promyelocyte, which is high scattered, and this is the blast gate. Using CD2, it clearly separates the blast, which is positive for CD2, and promyelocyte are negative for CD2. And CD34 again clearly divide the population to the blast to two population. The blast are positive for CD34, while the promyelocyte are clearly negative for CD34. Now look at the pattern number 4. I don't know if we could call it pattern because it's only one case. And this case shows mixture of hypogranular and hypergranular promyelocyte by morphology and also by flow cytometry. This is the hypo and this is the hypergranular, and CD34, by the way, is negative 18%. CD2 clearly separate the hypo and the hypergranular. So now take this case. 20 years old male, previously well admitted with shortness of breath, fatigue for 3 weeks. On examination, he's pale looking, vitally stable, no lymphadenopathy or organomegaly. WBC is normal, RBC is low, 2.4, and hemoglobin is 8.2, and platelet is, he's severely thrombocytopenic. LFT and UNA normal, coagulation normal, medical and family history are remarkable. This is the peripheral blood, and it shows marked anisobiculocytosis with circulating erythroid precursors. They did a bone marrow and they discovered that he has erythroid hyperplasia, many basophilic erythroblasts, proerythroblasts, along with those cells. He has myeloblasts also. So what do you think? What is the most important differential diagnosis here? Okay, now look at this. This is the trephine biopsy. It shows 100% cellularity with erythroid hyperplasia and many immature looking cells in between. This is glycoprotein A, which shows clear positivity. CD34 is scattered positive, and MBO again is scatteredly positive, like equivalent to CD34. So when we do the differential, we discover that the erythroid precursor is the predominant cell. 78% of the bone marrow cells are erythroid with significant dysplasia. Myeloblast is 10% out of all nucleated cells, and myeloid and megakaryocyte are both reduced without significant dysplasia. So now what is the diagnosis? It is pure erythroid leukemia. What is the definition of pure erythroid leukemia? More than 80% erythroid and less than 5% myeloblast. But here I have less than 80 and I have 10% myeloblast. So this is out of all nucleated cells. Now, if you want to approach to any patient with erythroid hyperplasia, with erythroid, mainly erythroid leukemia, you have to count the myeloblast out of what? Of non-erythroid cells. Now, if we take the percentage of the myeloblast out of non-erythroid cells, it will be 10 out of 22. So it will be around 45%. So this is real case of acute erythroid leukemia if you exclude the better chemotherapy and recurrent cytogenetic abnormality, it will be AML and otherwise specified, and according to that count, it is acute erythroid leukemia, mainly erythroid myeloid leukemia. Now take this case. This is a real report case actually, published in the Journal of King Faisal, Hematology Oncology Stem Cell Journal. This is a 31-year-old male patient admitted with fever and respiratory tract-like illness. And WBC shows actually pancytopenia. The WBC is 3, the RBC is 2.4, and hemoglobin is 8.2, and the platelet is moderately thrombocytopenic, 34. And the bone marrow, actually, they did the bone marrow, this is the bone marrow, aspirate, it shows around 88% of immature cells. What kind of immature cells here? Those are mainly erythroblasts. So he has more than 88% immature cells. And this is the trephine biopsy, which shows 100% cellularity with erythroid hyperplasia. Flow cytometry shows the majority of the gated cells are dim to negative CD45, and they are positive for glycoforin A, and they are negative for MBO and other myeloid and lymphoid marker. So what is the diagnosis here? Pure erythroid leukemia. Look at this. This is erythropoietin-induced acute erythroid leukemia picture. And actually, when they dig at the history, when they check the history, this patient is a known case of chronic hemolytic anemia, and he had been maintained on erythropoietin for 3 months, which according to his hematologist decreased the transfusion requirements. So they close follow up this patient, and they admit him, they don't give him any kind of chemotherapy, and 1 month later, the bone marrow normalized after they stopped the erythropoietin treatment. So the message behind this is this slide. You have to exclude all the other causes that leads to reactive erythroid hyperplasia before you entertain the diagnosis of pure erythroid leukemia or acute erythroid leukemia. And those are the most important condition that you need to roll out, namely the erythropoietin. And according to the WHO, actually the WHO, they talk about the erythropoietin, the exclusion of erythropoietin and the main text, but they don't put it in the algorithm. So this is why what make sometimes many diagnostician will make, this mistake. The hemolysis, again, you need to exclude the hemolysis. And our patient, he has two parameters here. He's a known case of chronic hemolytic anemia, and the chronic hemolytic anemia will cause what? Will cause erythroid hyperplasia, and he has been maintained maybe and appropriately on erythropoietin, so he presented with respiratory infection, which make him leukopenic, and from the beginning he was anemic, and then you need to exclude the hemoglobinopathy, which is congenital hemolytic anemia, and more importantly B12 and folate deficiency, because sometimes megaloblastic anemia may mimic the acute erythroid leukemia. Now, this is a real case of pure erythroid leukemia, and we have excluded the erythropoietin and the hemolytic anemia. This is a 57-year-old female presented with shortness of breath and chest pain. He's a febrile with normal vitals, few pulses, but there's no bleeding. And the platelet count, he is severely thrombocytopenic, and he's severely anemic. And what is this? This is the BAS stain, which is usually abnormal. It will show block-like pattern positivity in abnormal pro-erythroblast. Because BAS stain what? BAS stain what? Stains what? it stains the glycoferrin. So any abnormal localization of the glycoferrin, it will give us the block-like positivity. And this is the peripheral. This is the peripheral smear. It shows many circulating erythroblasts, and this is the bone marrow, which was poorly differentiated erythroblast. And the bone marrow shows almost 100% infiltration by immature-like cells. They are completely negative for CD34, which is very important according to the WHO definition. Glycoferrin, now you could compare between glycoferrin and ecadrin. Glycoferrin stains what? Stains mainly the a little bit intermediate and late erythroid precursors. But ecadrin is a selective marker for pro-erythroblast and basophilic erythroblast. Look at this article, actually. This article has been published in Modern Pathology. They actually report the largest series of pure erythroid leukemia, which is around 18 cases, and they say that ecadrin emerged as the most sensitive and specific marker for mature erythroblast and was helpful in distinguishing pure erythroid leukemia from other erythroid proliferation. And actually many articles actually proofing that, so it should be used. Now this is a very simple slides. Acute erythroid leukemia is an acute leukemia that are characterized by predominant erythroid population. It represents less than 5%, and it has been divided to pure erythroid leukemia and acute erythroid myeloid leukemia. And I'm sure that if you don't read the history, you will not understand the current situation, and you will not predict for the future. And this is general rule, not in hematopathology. Now, the first case of acute erythroid leukemia was described at 1912, and then Gagliamo presented the first case of pure erythroid leukemia. Then at 1985, the major breakthrough was occurred by Temeschk and Bladini, when they proved that we are dealing with real leukemia, and they adopt the name of digagliamo. And then the FAB classification, they recognized acute erythroid leukemia, but they don't recognize the pure erythroid leukemia, and they put it as extreme end of MDS. And many cases at that time, before the WHO classification 2001, has been categorized as MDS, and usually it is MDS with multilineage dysplasia. WHO 2001, they recognized the acute erythroid leukemia, and they changed the definition of all leukemia, I mean the threshold of myeloblast, from 30% to 20%. So it changed the whole picture, including the acute erythroid leukemia. And they recognize the pure erythroid leukemia as immature erythroid cells, more than 90% and less than 5% myeloblast. And then 2008, they keep the same definition, and they don't change anything at acute erythroid leukemia, but they add a new category which actually would change maybe the whole story. If you check the literature between 2001 and 2008, you will find many cases of pure erythroid leukemia. And many actually I have seen reported with 18 cases, 12 cases, 10 cases. But now after 2008, you hardly find any case of real pure erythroid leukemia, because the new addition, which the acute myeloid leukemia with myelodysplasia related changes. Because actually the majority of pure erythroid leukemia will show what? At the genetic level. In the article that I already showed to them, 18 cases showed very complex karyotype. The median of the karyotype, I mean the number, the median cytogenetic abnormality is 12 cytogenetic abnormality. So all the cases has been categorized here under acute myeloid leukemia with myeloid dysplasia related changes. And now, this may be the last slide. How to approach for any patient with erythroid hyperplasia, by definition more than 50%, and he has dysplastic changes. First of all, you need to exclude all the reactive causes, mainly erythropoietin, B12, folate, and others. If you have excluded all the reactive causes, you have to check the history for any previous chemotherapy or radiotherapy. If there is previous chemotherapy or radiotherapy, it is therapy related myeloneoblasm, whatever the erythroid count, whatever the blast count even. And now you need to check the recurrent cytogenetic abnormality. If the patient is showing any one of the recurrent cytogenetic abnormality, it is AML with recurrent genetic abnormality. And then this is the position of the new category. I mean, this is the place of new category in the algorithm. So it is actually, it is before the pure erythroid leukemia, and if it is before the acute erythroid myeloid leukemia. So if the blast is more than 20% and the patient shows, more than 50% dysplasia involving more than two lineage, and or if there is MDS-related genetic abnormality or previous MDS, any one of those criteria along with 20%, and if you have excluded all the previous causes, it's AML with myeloid dysplasia-related changes. If the case is not fitting for any one of the above mentioned criteria, you should check now. You should count the blast out of non-erythroid cells. If it is exceeding more than 20%, this is acute erythroid leukemia. If it is less than 20%, this is myeloblast. this is MDS. And now, if it is not fitting for any one of those entity, you have to check the erythroid. You have to calculate the erythroid. If it is more than 80%, with less than 5% myeloblast, this is pure erythroid leukemia. And now, look at this. This is the last case, which is very interesting. Now, this is the cytospin, and this is the bone marrow aspirate. What is the abnormality here? All these are blast. This is blast. But what is the abnormality here? From that side, I'm sorry. What is the abnormality here? What is this? Is this a footprint of any kind of any? What is this? What? This is RBC. So what could we call that phenomena? Erythrophagocytosis. So now, do you know any recurrent cytogenetic abnormality or any case that is associated with that phenomena? You sound excluded because you have seen the slide. It is the acute myelomonocytic leukemia translocation 816. This is just for fun. It is very rare case, by the way, less than 100 cases reported yet. And usually it is associated with acute myelomonocytic leukemia. And the erythrophagocytosis is usually done by what? By the monoblast, not the myeloblast. And it is very rare subtypes, representing less than 0.2 of de novo AML, according to the articles. And usually they will show prominent erythrophagocytosis by monoblast. The immunophenotype of those type of translocations 1816 will be like M4. And they are characterized by frequent extramedullary disease, and usually it is associated with poor prognosis. And thank you. على فكرة هذه صورة حقيقية, وهذا جبل, هذا جبل أجا في شهر, في أول شهر أبريل لكنها only for 2 weeks لحد يروح الآن.
Thank you, Dr. Mansour, for a really nice presentation. Any question? Okay.
السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته.
Now according to WHO, the category which is named AML with the MDS related changes requires one of three items to put the AML case in this category. Either to have previous history of MDS or more than 50% dysplastic changes into lineage or MDS related cytogenetic abnormality. And this is quite long cytogenetic abnormality. Now my question, if patient came with it and he has AML and has one of this MDS related abnormality and at the same time has one of the recurrent cytogenetic change abnormalities, where to put him?
Yes, okay. This is a smart question, actually. Now, if we are talking about, we have to know that if we are talking about the diagnosis, this is something else. The prognosis actually is something also, something else. Now, according to the WHO, the diagnosis, we should categorize those patients as the according to the recurrent cytogenetic abnormality. Say, you know, if he has translocation A21 and he has monosomy 75Q, deletion 20, minus Y, whatever. And now, you should diagnose him as translocation A21. What about the prognosis? Does it make any difference if he has recurrent cytogenetic abnormality? This issue has been studied very well in very good article, and they said yes, it make big difference, but they don't change it because they need more study. Because as I said, this is a new category. So I think at the new version of the WHO, they may address this issue.
Okay. Any question? Okay. Thank you, Dr. Mansour.